Hello everybody, welcome to part 3 of Rob Wilson. Thank you for watching the video. You are making the right decision because this is a huge scandal that's hit the UK, and it's to do with the post office and Fujitsu. And there are other YouTubers doing similar sort of videos. There's DPS Computing. I do recommend that channel immensely. And Art of Law, which I also promote profusely. I don't get any kind of money or anything saying that. I'm just saying there's other options if you don't like my videos and you want to watch different angles of it. We are all together. We're not rivals. Everybody has the right to be angry with what's happened with the post office. Let's get on with part 3. This part may seem quite long, but this goes into detail of what is expected of experts. I'm still going to add it into this video because I think it is important. Bear with me. I think we'll all understand this and enjoy listening to this because it's going to be much more important when phase 5 and 6 starts in a couple of days' time.
Yes. So dealing with the first sentence then, what guidance was given to expert witnesses?
I don't recall...
Well, hold on, I haven't asked a question yet.
Sorry.
I was pausing myself.
Okay.
In relation to what you say there,
yeah.
The guidance given was the same as a non-expert witness. Namely, they should be told to tell the truth. And if it proved otherwise, they could be liable to prosecution. That tends to suggest that they were told two things. Yes? And they were only told those things that also applied to a witness of fact, a non-expert. Is that right?
Sorry, say that again, please.
Yes. It tends to suggest that they were told the same things as applied to a witness of fact, a non-expert witness, namely the duty to tell the truth and the consequences if they didn't tell the truth, i.e. they could be prosecuted.
Yes.
You may know that we've received some expert evidence ourselves on the duty of an expert witness across the period 2000 to 2013, on the relevant duties of an expert witness, and upon the duties upon a prosecutor seeking to rely on an expert witness across that period. And I want to put, if I may, some elements of the evidence that we heard to see whether you agree or disagree with them. Would you agree that the prosecutor must provide an expert with instructions as to the issue or issues upon which his or her opinion is sought?
Yes.
Would you agree that the prosecutor must provide the expert with questions which the expert is expected to address or to answer?
Yes.
Would you agree that the prosecutor must supply an expert with material upon which the prosecution relies and which may be relevant to the questions which the expert is expected to answer?
Yes, the evidence is relevant, yes.
Do you agree, secondly, that throughout this period, 2000 to 2013, a prosecutor intending to rely on expert evidence in criminal proceedings was under a duty to satisfy themselves as to the expert's relevant qualifications and expertise?
Yes.
They were required to satisfy themselves that the expert had been appropriately instructed, included by the provision of a letter of instruction or terms of reference?
Yes.
That they were required to satisfy themselves that the expert had been informed as to their relevant duties, including a duty to the court?
Yes.
That the prosecutor in that period was required, would you agree, to satisfy themselves that the expert had understood and had complied with their duties to the court?
Yes.
The prosecutor, would you agree, was required to satisfy themselves that any literature or material which undermines the expert's conclusions had been reviewed by the prosecutor and, where appropriate, disclosed to the defence?
Yes.
And lastly, the prosecutor was required to bring to the attention of the defence and to the court any material which the prosecutor was aware was reasonably capable of undermining the expert's opinion.
Yes.
And that includes matters relating to the expert's qualifications, the factual basis for their opinions, and their credibility.
Yes.
Thirdly, would you agree that if a prosecutor wishes to rely on an expert witness in this period, the prosecutor must be, or is duty bound to ensure that the individual concerned, the expert, actually understands that they're giving evidence in the capacity of expert witness, and therefore special duties apply to them?
Yes.
Fourthly, would you agree that any duties of disclosure that are required to be discharged are those of the prosecutor, and that they can't subcontract them to the expert themselves?
Yes.
Fifthly, would you agree that if a party seeks to rely on an expert who is not functionally independent of a party in the case, then the party is under an obligation, a particular obligation, to show that the expert understands the duties to which he or she is subject?
Yes.
And that applied in this case, in that if expert witnesses, such as Mr. Gareth Jenkins, were called, who were not functionally independent from the post office, they were not akin to conventional experts who were accustomed and trained to giving expert evidence. Your team were under a particular duty to ensure that those individuals, including Mr. Jenkins, understood the duties to which they were subject.
Yes.
You tell us at the beginning of this paragraph that the guidance given to expert witnesses, what they were told, they needed to tell the truth, and if they weren't, they could be prosecuted. Does it follow that the list of things that I just read out were not undertaken in relation to experts called by or on behalf of the post office in the relevant period?
Yes.
And how did that come about then?
Because at the time, I believed that Gareth Jenkins understood his duties, that he was cross-examined by the defence and examined in chief by the prosecution to outline his expertise, and that from that information I believed that he fully understood that he was independent and objective, irrespective of the fact that he was employed by Fujitsu and was giving evidence in relation to his employer and Post Office Limited.
The things you've just spoken about there all happened once he was in the witness box.
I understand that.
The things I've spoken about happen before we get to the witness box, don't they?
Yes.
What was done to ensure the list of things that I have read out that all happened before somebody walks into the witness box were done?
I don't recall. I don't specifically recall ever seeing Mr. Jenkins, although I must have met him at some point in time. And I believe I may well have been present when he was in court, although I can't recall that happening.
Forgive me for taking you through all that, but I just thought it was really interesting to know what is expected of an expert in the full context, because it was dribs and drabs. So if you've not seen my previous videos, or you've not watched The Inquiry, and you've not watched DPS Computing, Art of Law, or Black Belt Barrister, at least now you can see for yourself. I have cut over an hour's worth of this down to half an hour. Obviously, you've got me chipping in every now and again, but you're still saving lots of time and you're getting what is happening. It's all recorded in the right order. I do not chunk bits out and rearrange it. It's all in order. I'm just trying to make it more interesting for you to keep your attention, especially when Rob Wilson has the rhythm of speech and speed of speech that is as dull as watching paint dry and really monotone and really lethargic. Moving on to a little bit more on Gareth Jenkins.
I may be wrong in saying that I thought he was a professor. He certainly had some qualifications that appeared to be relevant to his position within Fujitsu. I forget whether it was a doctorate or some other qualification. So my understanding from his qualifications is that he appeared to be an expert in his particular field.
I wonder if Rob Wilson also called Gareth Jenkins doctor, if he thinks he had a doctorate, or has he just read the report by, I've forgotten the person's name who wrote the report, who kept calling him Dr. Jenkins. Anywho, I wonder if he's just read that report as well. The Clark advice. Yes, I remembered. I do have a memory. Moving on now to a couple of cases that were quashed. Pause if you want to read this bit, and this bit, and this bit. Let's get started.
The court says these factors, that's the factors addressed in the preceding three paragraphs, are sufficient for the court to quash Mrs. Hall's convictions on both grounds one and two. We were, however, presented with further information which bolsters our conclusion that Mrs. Hall's prosecution should not have been brought, and which forms the basis of the post office's concession under ground two. On the 30th of June 2011, the post office's external solicitor wrote to you, recording what had taken place in court that day, including the basis on which Mrs. Hall had pleaded guilty to fraud as an alternative to theft. Despite the fact that Mrs. Hall had not sought to make any express criticism of Horizon in her defence, the attendance note records the fact that it was made clear that, quote, the prosecution would not accept any criticism or blame concerning the Horizon system.
So weird.
The post office accepts that it was improper to make the acceptability of Mrs. Hall's basis of plea to fraud conditional on not making any criticism of the Horizon system. This is an exchange of emails with Diane Chan, who I think was counsel who prosecuted cases for the post office. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
And it's an exchange with you, and I think we can glean what's necessary from the top of this page. You say to her, on the 17th of November 2010, Diane had received a defence statement today, despite the telephone conversation earlier, hard copy put in the post. At point two, the defence alleged that any discrepancy was as a result of the Horizon system. There's also a challenge to the initial missing figure of £18,000, which was reduced according to the defence statement in a matter of minutes. The statement also maintains that further investigation by the auditor, quote, would have discovered the whereabouts of the alleged missing sum. And then you say, clearly, if there were to be a plea to false accounting, but on the basis that the Horizon system was at fault, that would not be an acceptable basis of plea for the prosecution. And the last piece of evidence, please. This is from a member of your team, Ms. McFarlane, yes?
Yes.
And if we just scroll up, please, to the page above so we can just get a date. 1st of December 2006. Yes. And then scroll down, please. Mandy, Thomas is my case. He was charged with theft of about £48,000. He blamed the online banking system, claiming that reports had several transactions showing nil transaction. This was looked into, and the investigator remained of the opinion that the entries were deliberate and to facilitate fraud. Mr. Thomas's expert examined the Horizon, I understand, from the officer that he took no issue with the system and informed the officer that we'd be hearing no more. No defence expert report was served. Following the visit, Mr. Thomas's solicitor offered a plea to false accounting, that in doing so he would not blame Horizon. This was accepted to avoid the cost of a trial, 9 months imprisonment, confiscation proceedings. So this is describing a plea negotiation involving Huey Thomas, yes?
Yes.
On the basis that the plea would not involve a blame being directed towards Horizon. Now, you address this practice, plea negotiations, on the basis of Horizon never being blamed. In your witness statement at page 25, you say there are examples in a number of prosecutions where plea bargains were struck before trial, where the post office would offer no evidence on a charge of theft in exchange for a guilty plea on a charge of false accounting. You give some references. I did not draft charges, you say in 58, of theft in order to put pressure on defendants to offer guilty pleas to charges of false accounting. Charges of theft were only drafted when the evidence was such that it was believed there was a realistic prospect of conviction of the offender in relation to the theft charge. 59, I considered that a plea to false accounting would not be acceptable if it was put on the basis that the Horizon IT system was at fault, because I did not believe this was true, and as such felt that such a plea could not properly be accepted. Years of operating as a lawyer in the criminal law team, and then as head of it, had you ever heard of a decision of the Court of Appeal called Eden addressing the post office charging practice of charging counts of theft and false accounting?
Yes.
What guidance was issued to prosecutors about the Court of Appeal's comments about the post office's practice of charging those counts on an indictment?
The guidance that I gave was that they should not charge alternative allegations of theft and false accounting, that they should follow Eden.
And where is that written down?
I wrote it to my team.
In a guidance document?
No. I noticed that there was a practice amongst some lawyers of charging both theft and with an alternative false accounting, which I disapproved of.
And why did you disapprove of it?
Well, because it didn't follow RV Eden.
And in what respect was it wrong?
Well, it was wrong because RV Eden effectively said you should pin your colours to the mast. There is a case of RV Julian Wilson amongst the papers.
Yes.
Where I took on some papers that one of my colleagues was responsible for. They were on holiday. My practice in charge of being in the criminal law team was that if somebody was on holiday, it was an opportunity for me to undertake work that was necessary at the time to see what was going on cases. It was one of the measures that I took. In this particular case, Julian Wilson, the lawyer had charged both theft and false accounting. I prepared the instructions for counsel because the case had been committed for trial, and I dropped the charge of theft, proceeded with a charge of false accounting, and in the instructions, I referred counsel to my opinion that there was the evidence in relation to theft was not, I can't remember how I described it, but was not good. And that's why I had dropped the theft charge and preferred the false accounting. Now, I will have taken that up with the lawyer involved, and at that stage, I would have probably reminded the team that my instructions were that you shouldn't charge both theft and false accounting. You should be pinning your colours to the mast.
I'm sorry, when he says when colleagues go on holiday, that's when he decides to stick his neb in to have a look to see what's going on. And also, I think it was the victim, wasn't it? The sub-postmaster whose last name was Wilson. Maybe he just felt, oh, look, someone's got the same name as me. Let's see what they're up to. And oh my word, maybe they shouldn't be charged with theft and false accounting. And we know that we've got a good feeling, haven't we, by watching these videos, that they were charged with both. because then if they failed on one, they could just get them on the other, which is not how the law is meant to work. But obviously the post office could bring their own cases to court. People are saying, oh, he's old. And there's people sometimes say about our country, we've got the statute of limitations and this, that and the other. Well, I don't really want to be in that boat, because just because you've left a company or you are... I mean, I'm going to presume that this bloke is in his late 60s. What he says in this inquiry is still relating to other people who are younger, and he still did something and was part of something that was leading to the... You can't say the S word on YouTube, but I'll just say the deletion of lives. I am glad he's in that chair, and I'm glad that he's been interrogated. And this will especially become more sensical when you get to part four, because part four is really blood boiling. Well, steam will be coming out of your ears anyway.
And one of my concerns did involve a number of lawyers charging both theft and false accounting.
Did that happen more than once?
Yeah, more than once.
Why was it happening more than once?
Because people weren't probably listening to me.
I am fed up of listening to him. I do these videos and I have to watch the whole case, then I have to stamp it, timestamp it, then I have to record it with my timestamps, my scribbly notes. And just listening to Rob Wilson, as you've already gathered by now from parts 1 and 2, and you'll see from 3 and 4, the bloke is awful to listen to. So I'm not surprised that we're listening to him, because he needs to speak up, be clear, and be less boring when he speaks. That is obviously in no defence of the state of the mess that the scammy post office and Fujitsu are. I'm just thinking it's quite ironic that it wasn't being listened to. Now we're going to get to some real meat here. We're talking about the Horizon Integrity, what Rob Wilson thought of it, and the Ismay report, and everything, the emails. This will be leading on into part four as well.
By this time, if one picks the period of 2010, had there been any independent assessment of Horizon's integrity?
There hadn't been an independent assessment, but Rod... Ismay had prepared his report, I think it was in August 2010, which effectively vindicated the Horizon system.
And is that how you read the Ismay report, that it was a vindication of the Horizon system?
Yes.
Did you regard it as thoroughly independent and objective?
I believe it did. As far as I was concerned, it vindicated the system, yes.
We're going to come back to Mr. Ismay's report later, but he's told the inquiry that his instructions were, his terms of reference, were to look for and to include only evidence that showed that Horizon was a robust system and that the data that it produced enjoyed reliability and integrity, and not to include anything that showed otherwise. Did you know that?
No.
That it was a deliberately one-sided effort?
No, I didn't know that at all.
That the dice were loaded before he even set pen to paper, because it was a myopic view that only looked at material to back the system?
No.
You didn't know that?
No. I didn't at all. I think...
He's told us these things from the seat that you're sitting in.
Yes. No, had I known that, then I wouldn't have given any credence to I think I'd have asked him, well, what was wrong with the system at the time then?
Well, I think he would have replied, I'm not allowed to look. Were you relying on Mr. Ismay's report after August 2010, therefore, in adopting this practice of refusing to enter plea negotiations if they involved any blaming of the Horizon system?
Well, I wasn't refusing to enter plea negotiations. What I was saying to the defence is, depending on what they said in the defence statement, look, our view is contrary to your view, and that therefore this issue may have to be resolved by calling evidence.
Thank you, that can come down. Were you aware of, autumn 2010, of the discovery of the receipts and payments mismatch bug?
Was that the Juliet McFarland bug?
No, I don't think it was, from memory.
Is this the 40 officers?
I'm sorry?
There were 40...
40.
Officers.
1-4.
14?
Yes, I think.
No, I was aware of the Juliet McFarland, where I think there were two, the Horizon, it was the New Horizon problem. I was aware of a Dave Posnett single office problem, and I was aware of John Longman's. I don't recall this, the 14, and don't believe that there are any documents in my papers that refer to that one.
Did the information that you received about the problems that you have just identified to us affect your faith in the integrity of Horizon?
Horizon, the 2007 problem that Dave Posnett referred to, as I recall, was a single office, fix had been implemented the year after, and we were told in 2009, and I wrongly took the view that that needn't be disclosed. I felt at the time, now looking at it, I should have disclosed that issue. I don't think I considered that the integrity of Horizon had been destroyed by that. The Juliet McFarland issue, we disclosed to the defence, and I believe it was referred to in a generic witness statement that was prepared by Fujitsu. John Longman case, I've recently received some papers from you which explained what the case was.
Oh, I could send it to
40
sleep.
Officers, where there was a problem. And I've been able to read that, and I don't know what happened with that case, but that, as far as I can understand, it was a New Horizon issue. So far as Old Horizon was concerned, I didn't have any belief that there was a problem, A, because of the Rod Ismay report, and B, because the Seema Misra case had been comprehensively challenged, and we'd secured a conviction, and I thought that supported what we were doing.
Thank you. We're going to come back to those three disclosures of bugs.
Yes.
When you return on the 12th of December.
And that is it for part three. Anyway, thank you for watching. You are right to be angry. And even though the mass mainstream media have suddenly found some tapes and seem to be dominating the algorithm and search on YouTube, obviously there is, obviously myself, because you're watching me, and there's DPS Computing, Art of Law, and the Black Belt Barrister, who have also done videos on this IT Fujitsu post office scandal, whatever you like to call it. It is the worst cases of miscarriages of justice in UK history, and it deserves to be remembered. And you are doing the right thing by keeping informed about it and not just letting stupid other mainstream news articles like Kim Kardashian is wearing a new hat, or Kanye West's new girlfriend is not wearing very much, or Miley Cyrus has a new song out. You are keeping interested in the right stuff. Thanks for watching. Bye.